Okay, yeah, I'm glad that we managed to connect and so still be able to hear your talk. And so let me introduce, so this is Professor Giulia Galli from University of Chicago is our featured speaker for this morning. And I think, Giulia, you have an hour and a half for your presentation. Then we'll have some questions and answers. So I guess without further ado, welcome, and it's your turn.
Okay. All right, thank you. And I mean, let me start, by apologizing for not being there, really. The reason why I scheduled the trip, which was so tight, a one-day trip, is because of my teaching duties here. And during this quarter, I teach a Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday, and so I thought I could make it. But last night at O'Hare really didn't work out, and it was a combination of the weather and Obama coming in town, and when Air Force One lands in Chicago, they close a lot of runways. But anyway, I didn't make it, and thanks for allowing me to give the talk over the WebEx. So first of all, although I'm online, I really don't mind to be interrupted and to try to answer questions if there are during the talk. It's a long talk, so if there are questions all along, maybe we make it more lively and it will be better for everybody. So just raise your hands and I will stop. Maybe somebody will help me to stop and answer questions.
So before we go on, I think that just to resolve one little technical problem here, the sound, Jim said is that we have a microphone here, but I'm not sure if you'll be able to hear the audience, if they speak from their seats, or we can't move this microphone. So let's just give it a try now. So maybe someone can, who wants to say something from the audience? Maybe this person. Okay, so can you speak up and see if you can hear it? Yes.
Say something, so let's see. Can you hear him, Julia? You can hear me now?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay, it's good.
Okay, so that will be fine. So then, if someone has a question during the talk, and we encourage, as Julia said, we encourage you to interrupt and ask questions, raise your hand. I'll come to you with this microphone, and then we'll be able to hear better. Okay, so I think we're all set now.
Okay.
Thanks.
So what I prepared here is a lecture on what I call the heterogeneous system and multiple properties of heterogeneous system computed from first principles. And before getting into, the meat of the lecture, I would like to spend some time in introductory remarks to make clear what I mean by heterogeneous system and multiple properties. And this is important to understand in the context of problems that we have been interested in and that I guess many people are interested in these days. So the systems, solids and liquids and solid-liquid interfaces in nanostructure systems that I'll be talking about are related to materials that you may want to do to, for example, convert to solar energy, or materials that you may want to interface with water for energy problems, or also for just, for example, desalinating water or other problems of this kind. And also systems you may want to use for quantum information. So defective solids that you may want to use with specific spin states to form entangled states to use in quantum information technologies. So basically, any system that I'll be talking about, as I'm sure you have been used to look at in the school, is just a system made out of atoms, so everybody looks the same. It's whether you have a solid, a liquid, a nanostructure. And what I have in mind when I talk about heterogeneous system, for example, are systems for photoelectrochemical cells or solar cells. So let me just describe in a very general way. So I have in mind, for example, an oxide, which may be a highly correlated oxide or maybe a not a strongly correlated oxide. interface either with another oxide or with water, which of course itself is an oxide, that you use to absorb solar energy and then to generate electron hole pair to give to water to make a chemical reaction. Or I may be talking just about a semiconductor or, you know, different semiconductors interface together, or different nanoparticle of semiconductor interface together to create solar cells. Or again, you know, this is something I would not talk about this morning, but if you look at oxide interface with water for photoelectrochemical cells, these are systems that if you put them under pressure, you will find them in the earth. And they are very much related to how, to understanding how much carbon in terms of the CO2, CH4, I mean, methane, carbon dioxide you have in the earth. Or, you know, a system for water, for example, again, in same kind of, in general, problem. You have an interface between a solid and water, and the defects that I talked about to for qubits in solid, or again, material for thermoelectric generator. So this gives an idea that of the system that I have in mind. Of course, I will not talk into any details about these specific systems unless you ask me, but I wanted to present them from the start to tell you why we are interested in a heterogeneous system, because these are the problems that we have in mind. And if you have in mind these kind of problems, the solids that you will be interested in are heterogeneous. They have a lot of interfaces. I mentioned already, you know, solid-liquid interfaces, or interfaces between different solids or different nanostructure. They will have defects. Sometimes defects made on purpose to engineer them for quantum information technology, for example. And what is maybe relevant or more relevant to the school, they have mixed correlations. So again, unfortunately, I couldn't be there, you know, the first day yesterday, and first 2 days of the school, where people have defined, I guess, what strongly and not strongly correlated systems are. But certainly they have, you know, you can, whatever definition have been used, we will probably all agree that there are different solids that exhibit different kind of interactions, right, and different types of between electrons and different type of correlation. And if you're interested in the problems that I just mentioned, you will find all over very mixed kind of correlation, which makes the problems even more difficult. So let me give you an example here of really all variety of heterogeneities in systems that, for example, you may be interested in studying for artificial photosynthesis. So what's artificial photosynthesis? You may want to recreate what happens when you you know, absorb some light in leaves by using inorganic materials. And so you heat, for example, a solid by sunlight, and the solid is, in many cases, if you want to oxidized water in oxide. And this is a practical example that people use and that we have also studied in collaboration with the experimental group of Professor Kyung-Shin Choi at the University of Madison in Wisconsin, where you have a oxide, this is bismuth vanadate, covered by other oxides. And the bismuth vanadate in this case act as what we call the photoabsorber, meaning the bismuth vanadate is the material that absorbs the sunlight, and you create electrons and holes that are given to the catalyst, which is iron oxygen hydroxide or nickel oxygen hydroxide, that then are given to water and to make a chemical reaction. So first of all, you have a defective photoabsorber in terms of, you know, what I mean by heterogeneous. You have a three-way interface, catalyst, photoabsorber, and water. And let me point out, this is a hard, a solid, soft liquid interface. And then you also have a defective liquid, because if you wanted to do all this, you don't only need water. You need water with ions, with salt, like sodium chloride. And all this needs to be done at finite temperature. So an incredibly difficult problem. And why? Because you have very heterogeneous systems. And so they are in terms of the level of correlation that we are looking at. So what is bismuth vanadate? How correlated is this? How correlated is this in the pristine form or as a defective solid? How correlated is the iridium oxide? I mention iridium oxide because in many cases and in many practical problems, people, you know, not problems, devices, people have indeed used iridium oxide. And although you don't want to use it eventually because iridium is rare and very expensive. Actually, it's more expensive than rare. So again, you know, if you have these catalysts, nickel oxygen hydroxide, are they very strongly correlated system? Will DFC work? Will GW work if you look at the electronic states? And here, this is taken from one paper of the many that studied these cobalt-based catalysts by Kim et al. Published last year or 2 years ago. You know, these are cobalt-based catalysts, just some example of, you know, crystal structure, some very complicated. By the way, they are not dissimilar to some of the materials used in batteries. And again, the question arises, over and over again, how are we describing their electronic structure? In terms of finding interfaces in the materials, same thing for solar cells. Suppose that you want to do a solar cell made out of nanoparticles. And the reason you may want to do this is because it's cheap and because you can do it with very cheap, you know, colloidal chemistry methods. Then you are faced with the problem that nanoparticles are covered with ligands and form very complicated interfaces with kind of amorphous systems. And same thing if you want to do organic nanoparticles. Let me not insist on the organic part too much because I will not present examples on the organic one. Thermoelectrics to, you know, take waste heat and transform this into electricity or, you know, solar to thermal transfer of energy. Here, we have very interesting problems of, for example, correlation, type of correlation. And there is one thing that open problem, which is really interesting, which is that if you are looking about understanding thermoelectrics, you will find that some of the most efficient thermoelectric materials actually are topological insulators, so with a very high Seebeck coefficient. So why is that? This introduction was meant just to give you an idea of how heterogeneous in terms of structural properties, interfaces and defects, and level of correlation involved in the in system that you may be interested in studying for energy conversion problems like photoelectrochemical cells and solar cells or thermoelectrics, and in terms also of quantum information, especially if you're interested in defects. So with this in mind, this is the outline of the rest of my lectures. So I would like to start by pointing out, without entering into detail, how we establish structural models and how we pick structural models if we are interested in these systems. So, you know, if you're just interested to study a solid, highly correlated or not, at the temperature equals zero, for which you know exactly where the atoms are, this will not be a problem. But if you're interested in an energy conversion problem, which necessarily will be at finite temperature and necessarily will have interfaces, coming up with a good spectral model will be a problem, and you have to face that problem first. And you will never have a material and a structure which is exactly what experimentalists have. You will need to come up with a smart and robust structure which contains most of the features that you're interested in. Then, of course, you have to choose the electronic structure method that, as we will see, underlies all the multiple properties of the materials that you may want to have, you know, absorption, emission, and as we will see at the end of the lecture, transport. The electronic structure is at the basis of everything that we want to understand, really, for all the problems that I just mentioned. And I will spend some time telling you that if you are interested in this material, you really need to come up with ways of doing large-scale electronic structure calculations, and it's pointless to just do them brute force. And so there is a very important part here to develop algorithms to scale this calculation better, to method developments in electronic structure. And I, in particular, will tell you about large-scale calculation. GW calculation with ab initio molecular dynamics. And once we know how to do really well calculation for self-energies, we'll go back and come up with improved functionals from approximate self-energy to feed back to our ab initio molecular dynamics. And finally, I will close telling you that when you know all this, and when you are able to do this electronic structure calculation by combining density functional theory, many body perturbation theory with first principle molecular dynamics, you're ready to really do transport properties, electronic transport properties. Okay, so before I go ahead, I would like to ask whether, you know, the thing that I mentioned, like, you know, many body perturbation theory, correlation, and the GW, are things that you have, I mean, I will spend some time on GW, but are these things that at least in a vague sense you have heard about already in the school and most of people are familiar with, or did I say a lot of words that didn't make any sense to you? Can somebody give me, of course, the answer will be different for different people, but just an average answer here.
Raise your hand, or how should we answer that question?
No, I mean, just let me, maybe just by raising hands or telling, or maybe if there is somebody for which the words that I said so far were totally obscure, and if there are people will not be able, they think they will not be able to follow the rest, or if we are almost okay.
Okay, so any comments? Don't be shy. In this country, it's not good to be shy, as opposed to Europe.
Are we okay? I mean, could you follow this introduction more or less? Yes, no?
I would like to tell you, Giulia, that actually many people, including I am personally very, very much interested in this, because I also am interested in homogeneous and systems with disorder, and in particular correlated systems with disorder. So I think that this is something that in this area, in this group, not so many people have worked on inhomogeneous systems, but I personally believe that this is an upcoming field that's really that's very of great interest to many people as a next step where they can apply some of the methods that they're using currently, but that hasn't been done yet in this area.
I really think that, you know, for this, you know, this is a school, it's not a conference. So for this really to be useful for the students, if there are things that you don't understand, or if, you know, I am, you know, just thinking that, you know, if there are definitions, just stop me. stop me and I'll be able, you know, I have backup slides in my computer, so I can bring up many, many different things. So for this to be useful, when it becomes either too technical or not really understandable, stop me right away and I'll try to fix it. Okay, so again, we'll go from structural models to the electronic structure for these heterogeneous systems. I will spend some time on GW because, as I will show you in a minute, we really need the electronic states, maybe not at a level which is super accurate, but at least as a function of trends that makes sense with experiments to be predicted for heterogeneous systems. And then also I will take this opportunity to tell students that really it's important also not only to use codes, not only to, you know, just cram data in and out of codes, but to think about the importance of developing new methods and new algorithms. And this is where the innovation will be in the future, and just taking canned codes and just running them. It's important because you can understand and compare with experiments. But if you want to be an innovator yourself, at some point you will have to understand deeply the method and be able to modify them and to come up with new ones. And this is one example that I would like to give.
I would like to make a short comment, if I may interrupt you for a second.
Sure.
So yesterday we just heard a beautiful talk by Zilke Berman, who is right there. And Zilke is a young theorist in France. But what her big contribution in recent years has been is to, in fact, introduce use the GW method together with some other methods for strong correlations, because a lot of the work in correlations have focused on local interactions like Haber models, but did not really address the dynamical screening. And a lot of recent materials, it became clear that this is very important, and you really have to address the role of dynamical screening in many challenging materials, especially pinictites and a little bit more itinerant systems. So we had a good introduction how important this is, and I think your presentation is now giving us a different perspective on the same issue, which I think is just matches perfectly now.
Okay, all right. And I will be talking about dynamical screening specifically at the end, also when we validate our methods against other, our algorithms, I will say, against other methods, where I will point out that also numerically, you better get your dynamical screening really right. Otherwise, you don't go very far. Okay, so structural models. How do you come up with structural model of heterogeneous system? I just gave you a vague feel of the kind of system. So solid-liquid interfaces, maybe nanostructure system. So one way is to use first principle molecular dynamics. And so I guess that you all will probably know, at least intuitively, what molecular dynamics is. We solve the Newton equation of motion for a bunch of atoms classically, under the classical approximation, Boltzmann distributions. And when we do first principle molecular dynamics, as pioneered with the Carpinello method, we compute the force, so the potential between atoms on the fly by solving equations, Kohn-Chaum equation, and by doing density functional theory calculations. So this is an example, for example, of an interface between methane and, I believe, a diamond surface. You can do the same thing to have a structural model for your interface, for example, for photoelectrochemical cells or other problems, when you have an interface between a liquid and a solid. And then, this is a very good method. However, I mean, of course, how good it is and how faithful it is, that will depend on how good the level of DFT is. But I just want to make sure we understand here, we are talking about spectral models. So when we talk about how good DFT is for structural models, we talk about how good the DFT is to give you total energy, for which DFT has been devised and for which DFT is very good. So even if CFT will not give you the gap
we
of
have a
water,
question. Sorry.
Electronic gap or...
Just a second, I think we have a question.
Yes.
So here's a question.
Thank you. How do you model the semi-infinite slab? Is that a periodic cell in all three dimensions, or how do you do that?
So how do I model...
It seems that you
so
have...
What's the question? How I model the slab?
Yeah, what the cell is that you calculate
Yeah. Okay. So So for example, this is not the example that I was showing, but it's similar. So we set up a solid, like, I think this is silicon, but so we set up a solid slab in three dimensions in our periodic cell. And then we prepare a liquid like water, you know, previously simulated in another cell. And then we have a supercell, which can be, you know, a small supercell like this one in white, or can be a bigger supercell like this one, where you see all the atoms. And then we periodically repeat the whole system. So when you periodically repeat in three dimensions on top of this, you will see again the yellow, and then you repeat the liquid. So this is a three-dimensional cell. For example, in this case, it has 420 atoms and about 1,200 electrons. And then for all of the cells, we solve the deep step, the DFT equation. So, of course, you have to have very efficient codes to do this. Otherwise, you won't do this at each step. And in particular, here, this is a calculation like the one I was showing with the QBox code that you can download from to do first principle molecular dynamics. You can, it's freely available. You can download it. So this is how we set up our simulation.
Okay, here's another question.
It might be a stupid question because I don't know anything about molecular dynamics. So these two equations, do you solve them iteratively, or do you do a DFT calculation and then just use that as an input into Newton's equation, or do you need to iterate the whole procedure?
Sorry, I didn't. So for these two equations, can you say the first again?
Do you iterate these two equations? So is Fi updated as Ri is updated, or do you need to run a DFT calculation at every step of the iteration of the of Newton's equation?
Yeah. So so what we do, Newton equation is solved by finite differences. For example, with what we call the Verle algorithms, and so it's just really a discretization of an ordinary differential equation by finite differences, and we move by small steps, and we propagate by finite differences by doing a smart version of a Taylor expansion, which is what the Verle algorithm provides for you. At each of these steps, we solve the Kohn-Schramm equation, but we solve the Kohn-Schramm equation starting from the input wave function of the previous step, which is extrapolated in such a way that when you do and you solve it for the subsequent step, you are already very close to the ground state. So you need very small amount of steps. So if you started randomly at each step to solve your Kohn-Schramm equation, it would take forever. Because you use the input of the previous step, which is very close in terms of structure, this is not Monte Carlo, right? It's not random. It's an evolution of your system. Then the number of steps that you need is very small. That's what you do. But yes, the answer is yes. In principle, you solve the Kohn-Schramm equation at each step.
I would like to actually ask a question. So how different would be the results if you use, I mean, in the past, people used some effective force models which you can, you know, derive from density functional theories for given configuration, but not updating like this. So how, you know, how big is the difference in practice?
So the difference, so you mean you pre-calculate the potential energy surface?
Yeah, I mean that, you know, people, chemists used to use, I don't know, two body forces, or sometimes you can have angle-dependent forces, effective forces.
So this is, you know, for all the systems that I will be telling you about, this is basically not possible. In the sense that, for example, to find a force, so you can certainly find a force field to describe water in the absence of any dissociating ions in water, mm-hmm. or even in the presence of some dissociating ions. But to find the potential that tells you what are the kind of chemical reactions that are going on at the interface, you may, but it will only be as good as you put all the configuration that you already know about. And if you want a potential, for example, that tells you how, and I will have an example, a photoabsorber and the catalyst are interfaced together, and then there is another interface with water. There is no potential known that can do this for you, especially a potential capable of giving you the chemistry. So empirical potential are good if you want to simulate a system with no chemistry or with very known chemistry for a very long time. Otherwise, for these kind of systems, they are not really possible.
Sorry, here's another question. It's great that people are asking questions because one of our sponsors is ICAM, and they really encourage us to, you know, to have very interactive, and we have enough time, I think so.
Hello, and thank you. I would have a question regarding, I mean, this is a dynamical system in the end that you're trying to model here. So the dynamics will strongly depend on the temperature of the system, but how do you bring the temperature in these equations?
Yes, but that's a very good question. Absolutely. That's a great question. So this is the before I answer this question, I want to make sure that we all understand one thing. The ions or the ionic cores, you know, the atoms, so the proton, you know, the core of the atoms is treated as a classical system. So they undergo molecular, a classical dynamics, Newton's, right? What's treated quantum mechanically are all the interaction between the cores and the electrons and all the electrons among themselves. So because we have classical ions, the temperature so we can actually give some kinetic energy we can move the atoms, right? We can give some kinetic energy. And the temperature and the kinetic energy classically are the same thing, not the same, you know, it's 1/2 mv² equal to 3/2 nkBT. So once we know how the atoms move and how the kinetic energy of the atom is, and we know their numbers classically, we know their temperature. So how do we keep a temperature constant in the system? This has been worked out in the field of molecular dynamics over many years, and we actually use thermostats. By thermostat, I mean there are ways of coupling the system with a bath, with an external bath, which keeps the kinetic energy of the system the way we want it to be. And then from 1/2 mv² we have the, you know, nkBT. So, and these thermostats, for those of you who may have heard about that, are, you know, Nose thermostat, Nose Hoover thermostat, and so on and so forth. When you choose your thermostat, you should be careful in making sure that you have a thermostat that allows you to reproduce a canonical distribution of the system. So there are, you know, you need to know some stat mac and make sure that the canonical distribution here is reproduced. But the answer is kinetic energy and temperature are the same thing. It's a classical system. how do we kick the atoms and give them a kinetic energy that we want? We use thermostat by coupling the system to an external bath. So one thing that I want to say regarding the question that Vlad asked, so if you have empirical potential, you can simulate for much longer time than you can by solving the density functional theory at each step. So there are, you know, disadvantages in using DFT in this sense that, you know, you cannot do as long of a run, and then you cannot equilibrate also as big of a system. So can you do everything with first principle molecular dynamics? Of course, unfortunately not, because even if you had the perfect DFT, you cannot, in some cases, afford the time scales that are needed. So we use other type of systems, other type of methods that I don't want to explain in detail, but I want to give you a feel that they exist. For example, these are two works that we recently did in our group, but there are other groups working on the same topic. So suppose that you wanted to study, you know, phase transition of ensembles of nanoparticles, or even phase transition in solids. And the picture on the left-hand side shows you two different nanoparticles that are actually embedded in each other. They use these in solar cells. And we wanted to understand how you go from one embedded structure to the other. Molecular dynamics, even with classical cells, is not the right tools to use because the time scale are way too slow in molecular dynamics to allow you to study phase transition and to see what the system is. So you need to use advanced sampling. And advanced sampling techniques usually are still usable with classical MD. So what I wanted to get from that is, first principle MD is great. You can get a lot of information about structural models, but there are situations, and there are, for example, phase transitions that you cannot describe just by plain molecular dynamics, and you need to think about advanced sampling. So sampling the phase space of your system in a different way. Or you need to look at very many different configurations. For example, here, we first looked at different configuration of different ligands on the surface, of different molecules on the surface. We established their energetics as a function of a chemical potential, and then we came up with the most stable structural models that we brought into a molecular dynamic calculation. So we prepared the system by looking at total energies, and we picked a system closest to the configuration that we wanted to simulate without waiting for molecular dynamics to give us the most stable configuration. There are many different ways that people use to prepare structural models. One is first principle MD, one is coupling molecular dynamics with advanced sampling, and one is preparing the system close to where you want it to be by doing a lot of total energy calculations where you compare total energies at the DFT levels that then you would use in your MD to understand what's the most stable system that you want to start simulating. So when you have all this, for example, when you do molecular dynamics, you generate trajectories. What do I mean by that? You solve the equation of motion, Newton, and at each evolution of your system, you have X, Y, Z trajectories for the whole slab that tells you at this instant in time and at this temperature, the system is in this position. Then you evolve and you have all the other positions. On these and on each of these trajectories, you want really to do an average of your electronic properties at finite temperature with statistical errors, okay? For example, if you have a photoelectrochemical cell, you want all the trajectories that tells you at finite temperature how the atoms move at the interface. And then you want to understand how the levels are positioned. For example, here you have valence band and conduction bands with respect to certain levels of water. And how do you get that? This is not one configuration. This is a finite temperature system. A finite temperature system will never be represented by one configuration. It will be represented by an ensemble of configurations that the system explores at finite temperature, for example, during your MD. And your electronic state will not be represented by one, you know, PowerPoint state like this, which is just to give you an idea, but by the average of electronic structure calculation on all the trajectories that you have generated during your MD. And hence, your electronic state will have a statistical error bar, like an experiment. And these are the states with statistical error bars that you will compute if, for example, you want to understand how two materials are interfaced and how the states are connected to each other, you know, both for if you have an absorber in the water or if you have an absorber in the catalyst. And we have just written a paper on exactly the modeling energy level alignment at interfaces that just appeared actually 2 days ago in Nature Materials, if you're interested. So I would like to, we are clear about what we are computing here and the fact that the electronic properties are not one calculation on one structure, but are many calculations on all the structure that we have been computing during our MD. Are we clear on that?
Is there another question that you have over there related to that? I think maybe there is.
Yeah. So you were talking about having a surface with water connected to the, well, a surface between water and another material. Do you have to worry about conservation of particles inside of your periodic system? Do you have to worry about flow outside of the system, or do you take care of that some way? To keep the, like, how do you deal with that in your calculation?
So the simulations, all the molecular dynamic simulations that we do are at constant number of particles. They are, you know, defined as either NBE, constant number, constant volume, and constant energy, or NBT, constant number, constant volume, and constant temperature. The molecules diffuse, but we apply periodic boundary conditions. So you have your cell, so again, so the constant number, the number of particles is always constant, right? You have your cell, and the molecules diffuse, but your system is, for example, this one, and when the molecule gets out of here, by periodic boundary condition goes back on the other side. So the diffusion in a NVE or NVT, constant number of particle molecular dynamics, is taken care of by periodic boundary condition.
Just one more clarification here.
What about flow in the Z direction, though, like upwards? Do you have to worry about flow out of the system upwards?
This is the same thing. You know, you have to think that when the system is periodically repeated, there will be another solid part of the slab appearing here. So everything in all XYZ direction is periodically repeated with periodic boundary condition. So one more time before I go on, and unfortunately, you know, maybe if I were there, I could try to write at the blackboard. But so you have this equation at each time gets you a bunch of coordinates, right? And what we call trajectories are the ensemble of these coordinates as a function of time. And then on all these coordinates, you will have calculation done at the DFT level. And then what I want to do for all these coordinates, also do calculation at the GW level. And then I want to average, because it's this the way I get average properties in a molecular dynamics. I average over time. So when I do MD, the averages over time are a way, if the system is ergodic, to get ensemble averages, averages over statistical ensemble. And I do the same for electronic properties. And then I will have to put an error bar on my electronic properties, because I will have a finite number of, you know, coordinates of trajectories to average on. And when I do this, I determine these levels. I determine these levels with error bars that are not shown here, you know, the width of this bar. And I know where my bands are positioned, for example, with the level of water, or how the catalyst and the absorber levels are positioned. So if I want to know, once that I, for example, I absorb light by this absorber, and I want to know whether the charges are given to the catalyst, the problem that I have is the following. I have to determine whether the contact at this interface forms a Schottky barrier or a Fermi contact. And so this is an electronic structure problem where I have to determine, so where are all the levels of the absorber with respect to the Fermi level of the metals, in this case, the catalyst for the metal. So it's a real electronic structure problem made much more complicated by the fact that these are levels determined as averages at finite temperature. But the problem is the same. It's an old-fashioned problem of, is this a Schottky barrier or is this an ohmic contact? And why I want to know that? Because I want to know whether the charges absorbed here are given to my catalyst and then can be used to do a chemical reaction. Anyway, there are some explanation in this paper that that just came out, and especially there are a lot of references that we put there to you know, give an idea of what people do.
So I think we have another question here.
Hi. So you're talking a lot about this finite system, and I'm wondering, like, how do you mentioned the system, you know, of course it has to be ergodic, but how do you check for ergodicity breaking or some kind of symmetry, broken symmetry issues? Like, how can you account for that if it might show up in your system dynamically?
So are you asking how I check that the system is ergodic, or are you asking how do I check that the size of the system is correct?
The ergodicity question, the first one. So how do you know for sure that you haven't entered some broken symmetries or began?
So, you know, the honest answer to the ergodicity question is that we don't check.
Okay.
And we assume that the system is ergodic. This is the honest question. And, you know, we know of systems that are not ergodic, model system, you know, Fermi, Pascal, Coulomb, or whatever. But for all the system, by the way, with water, there have been many discussion about ergodicity, but we assume the system, it's fair to say that we do assume the system is ergodic, and to know whether the size is enough you do need to do finite size scaling,
right?
Which I use we as a community. I'm not saying we as, you know, my group. That we sometimes do, sometimes don't. And by the way, finite size scaling should be done for all properties. You know, you can have a system with a certain size that is good to describe the local structure of water or the local position shell of an ion, but it may not be enough to describe certain electronic states, and may not be enough to describe transfers. So finite size scaling is a tricky business. The reason why we don't do a good job yet at finite size scaling is because the calculations are so expensive that, you know, at least what we should do is to put statistical error bars on what we compute. And not very many people do that, and not very many people try to understand what the errors are. And sometimes we discuss differences that are inexistent because they are within error bars.
Okay, I think that answered that question. So I
okay.
Think.
Anyway, these are really good questions. You know, finite size scaling is open problem. And you know, if you, instead of doing ab initio molecular dynamics, you use these other methods where you have a bunch of configuration, you do exactly the same thing, right? I mean, you, for example, you know, compute energy levels, again, compute energy levels, you know, in donor acceptor solar cells or, you know, energy levels. This looks like a band structure, and it's a more complicated band structure because this is really not a good picture, but it's a complicated band structure because instead of being a band structure where the constituents are atoms, it's a band structure where the constituents are quantum dots, so big molecules, and so it's a little bit more complicated. And here the question was, are there states in the gap that can, you know, ruin the absorption of your energy, of your photon? So I thought this was to tell you about interfaces, right? Interfaces and how to determine the character of interfaces. The other heterogeneity that I talked about, which is very important, which is there either because you don't want it, it's always there at finite temperature, or because you want it to engineer systems, like for quantum information. The other heterogeneity is brought in by defect. For example, on the left-hand side is a picture of defects that are oxygen vacancies with a nitrogen substituting oxygen in bismuth vanadate. Bismuth vanadate we studied, as many other people, because for several reasons we studied it because it's used in photoelectrochemical cells. And we found out, not by ourselves, but in working in close connection with experiments, that actually to increase mobility and to increase the carrier concentration that you want in these materials, you need to have these. And if you couple oxygen vacancies and nitrogen, is a good thing. If you look from a distance and from the electronic standpoint, ions in water are exactly defects as, you know, impurities in bismuth vanadate. So if you have nitrogen in bismuth vanadate, it's not dissimilar from the point of view of the tools that you want to use and from the point of view of what happens than having an ion in water, salt in water.
I would like to ask a short question about this. You know, in solids, these defects are stuck, and so they cannot move. But in water, they can. So, for example, you know, you may imagine that you can lower the energy by clustering them or by moving them around or something. And how much difference is there in putting these ions in a solid where they cannot move versus water where they can move?
I am prepared. Look at this. this is, of course, a very important question. And, well, it is one of the most important questions. because you just said exactly what the problem, one of the most important problems is. If you have a solid, look at this, and you want to understand where the defect level is, you do a band structure calculation. You maybe look at different configuration of your oxygen and vacancy, and you determine where the level is. In water, see, this is the upper, is the highest occupied molecular orbital of water of the top of the valence band, the blue stuff, and this is the level of the ions. The level of the ions moves all the time, and in this case, it is particularly nasty because there are configurations where it is above water, and there are configurations where it is below water.
So how can it fluctuate on the electron volt level if the thermal energy is much smaller than that? This is confusing to me. How can it? How can that energy have such large fluctuations at room temperature?
Because here, if you look at the system here, the atomic structure, where you know the solvation shell around the ions here, right, and the atomic structure here is different, and then the ions move. Rearrange, and this corresponds, of course, to a difference in the electronic structure too, because you know you have to think. Unfortunately, I don't have a movie because I thought that I wouldn't show movie. But you know, if think of, think about this ion here, right? And the atomic, and it has surrounded by these molecules, but then it moves, and it is surrounded by other molecules, and this corresponds to a different electronic structure. And in the different electronic structure, the ions can go down. So the problem to determine what happens here is to average, and also to not only average the level here, but to understand how the localization of states changes. By the way, in a classical way, in an approximate way, here, you are taking into account all electron-phonon interaction, which is very important. Here you are, because this calculation is at fine, it's at zero temperature.
So in some sense, this water is like a very soft solid, right? So this polaronic effect, where you can self-trap the ion, it's stronger probably in water than in the solid, right, I guess?
It's huge.
Yes.
It's huge. It's huge, and you know there is no other way to take it into account than doing MD, because if you wanted really to do models like, I don't know, Frolic or whatever, you would never get there. The polaronic effect is huge and very important, very, very important.
Very,
and by the way, there are cases that are better where you have your level that stays always here, up here, right? But I'm showing this. This is a real calculation. It's not, you know, just PowerPoint, it's in this paper. And it is not unusual, and it's important because there are a lot of interaction between the level and water. Okay.
Just one short question. How important is to adding the GW correction to the density function?
Oh, yes. Basically, if you don't have a GW correction here, you don't even get close qualitatively to describing your system. And I will have, so now what I want to do is to tell you which the GW, how we do it, and I will get back exactly to this picture and exactly to a defect in a solid to tell you how important it is. And the fact that here, if you do not use GW correction or special hybrid functional, you don't even get close qualitatively to experience.
That's very interesting.
Okay, so I would like to now tell you about electronic structure calculation, and I will assume that you know at least the basic of DFT, you know what DFT is, and I will tell you how to do GW on DFT. A book that, I've used extensively in electronic structure, the book by Richard Martin, Electronic Structure, and in my graduate classes to talk about many-body perturbation theory, I started using this book that came out last year by Richard Martin, Lucia Reining, and David Severly. Both books are really excellent. I strongly recommend both books. And by the way, this book here starts exactly at the very beginning with the question, what's correlation, which is a question that I sent around before the starting of the school that I was hoping to discuss with the other people in the school. And also, it describes a little bit how, you know, confusing it might be sometimes that this concept is, but at the end, it defines correlation as what is left, you know, on top of R2-form. Anyway, so part of my lecture now on GW are mostly, you know, are my own stuff, but starting from electronic structure book, and some of the stuff is also taken from this book that, as I said, they are excellent, and I strongly recommend, and I use them in my classes. Okay. So, so suppose that we do our MD. Suppose that we are able to do our DFT at some level. The DFT level, I will go back to that. And suppose that we want basic electronic structure properties like photoemission and absorption. Okay, this is the basic stuff. So if we go back to one of our examples, photoemission is related to the position of the bands, right? Because when we do a photoemission experiment, we extract electrons from a certain system, and if we believe band picture of a solid, we are understanding where the band, how the bands are positioned. And if we do an absorption spectroscopy, for example, UVVs or ellipsometry, we are actually sampling, we are probing an electron hole pair, for example, in a semiconductor, right? We are understanding a two-particle excitation. So in terms of Green's function, so these are the experiments. In terms of theory, the single particle Green's function, the poles represent energy to add or remove an electron. And the two-particle correlation function, the poles corresponds to neutron excitation of interacting electrons. And I think that it's always useful when we start computing stuff to understand what is the physics and what how we measure the stuff that we are computing, right? So if we look at the poles of our single particle Green's function, we have in the back of our mind photoemission experiments and position of bands. And if we look at poles of the particle correlation function, we are targeting absorption. How do we compute? So process of interest, experiments, the theory, what are the equations that we're solving? If we want G and we are interested in photoemission, we may want to solve the Dyson equation, starting from our DFT. Which relates the Green's function to an effective potential of interacting electron, which is not called potential, it's called self-energy, but this is historical. If we want optical excitation, we solve the Bethe-Salpeter equation, which gives us how the two-particle function is related to the variation of the effective potential sigma with respect to the Green's function. We wrote a paper a couple of years ago where we tried to make exactly this connection between experiments and Green's function theory based on the idea that we wanted to compute all this as response functions from DFT. So, if all this doesn't tell you anything, it's okay, because what I'm going to do next is to try and tell you what is the approximate form of Dyson equation that we solve, how we get G, and how we interpret photoemission experiments, and especially how we interpret photoemission experiments for ions in water. So I want to tell you how important it is to use all this machinery to study this problem. And I will not talk about beta saltpeter, but if we understand this, we have understood a lot of the algorithm also to do beta saltpeter. They are explained here too. Okay, so let me start here. So what we do, basically, we solve on top of DFT the equations that have been proposed in this paper in 1965 by Lars Hedin to express the self-energy interacting, the potential in which interacting electrons move in terms of the dynamically screened Coulomb potential. So if you look at the first equation, you recognize a Kohn-Sham equation where you know, Vxc is the exchange correlation potential. And you can compare this to the approximate form of the Dyson equation that Hedin suggested, which is in a way kind of the same, except that instead of the exchange correlation potential, you have this interacting potential between interacting electrons, which depend on the single particle energy, the quasi-particle energy, QP quasi-particle, that we want to compute. And these are the equations that we will try to solve here and to find fast algorithms to solve.
If I can just interrupt you with one short question here. So I understand correctly, this is a GW correction to density functional theory.
This version. This is not yet that. This equation is an equation that is that will give you a GW correction to density functional theory if you solve it perturbatively, starting from Kohn-Sham state.
Okay.
This is an equation that you may solve self-consistently, that you may solve starting from Hartree-Fock,
yes,
that you may solve starting from other states other than Kohn-Sham state. If you solve this equation here perturbatively,
yes,
which is how it is presented down here,
yes,
which is not the only way of doing it, but it's a way of doing it.
But is it true that if you do it fully self-consistently, then it doesn't, it, the result doesn't really depend on the density functional theory at all?
It doesn't, although what you get, yeah, it doesn't. But let me put it this way. Although what you get will depend on the approximation of also of your self-energy. So I mean, I'm giving you a very approximate version of this. You know, the Hedin ideas to solve the Dyson equation is more complicated, and we are using an approximate form of even Hedin. So we are saying that the self energy is GW, is the Green's function time the screen Coulomb interaction. In the original approximate form of Dyson, there is another term, which is gamma, which is a derivative,
yeah,
of the self-energy.
Yes.
And so when you solve the equation self-consistently, there is an issue on whether you include this or not.
But is there,
by the way, I want to say something, since I brought up this. So Hedin paper was a revolutionary paper published in PRB in 1965, the same year that Kohn-Sham wrote their papers. And, you know, he suggested a lot of things that is still the ideas we work on today. And he writes, you know, besides the proof of a modified Luttinger-Ward-Klein variational principle, and a related self-consistency idea and all that, there is not much to do in this paper. So it's unbelievable. You know, today, you know, somebody looking at this program, we would publish 10 papers. We would all try to make it, you know, in PRL and all that. And nobody ever would dream to say that in their paper there is not much new stuff. Lars had in 1965. It's refreshing to see that, you know, 50 years ago, people could still afford to say these things after publishing such papers.
So we have a short question here from Stu.
Thanks. So will you always end up at the same solution if you're doing this self-consistently, or is this...
Sorry, I didn't understand.
Will you always end up with the same solution, or does it depend on the starting value where you start the iteration in a practical calculation?
No. Actually, absolutely not. And I have an example where I will show you here. How different, going back to the spectrum, how different the solutions are depending on where you start from. And let me get back to this question. The answer is no, and sometimes the solutions are very similar, sometimes the solutions are strikingly different. Okay, so we saw a approximate form of Hedin's equation, which are a way of rewriting the Dyson equation. Remember, Dyson equation are these, right? They relate G to the self-energy sigma. And we write sigma as G Green's function times W. Okay, so now what is W? W is a dynamically screened Coulomb interaction. So it is expressed in terms of now response function. So we are mixing here. Many body perturbation theory and Green's function and response function that we will compute from DFT if we want the GW correction to DFT. So what is W? W is the epsilon to the minus 1, the inverse dielectric matrix times the screen Coulomb interaction. And now I want to spend some time to tell you what is the physical meaning of epsilon. I have many slides on that. I will not go, of course, on all the details. I put them there if you're interested. The reason why I am focusing on this is for several reasons. One is, this is the link between diagrammatic expansion and many body perturbation theory with the theory of response function. And it's the way we actually are able, by making this link, to use DFT states to do GW. And also because in our own implementation of GW, which allowed us to go to very large scale calculation, we found a way to compute this dynamically screened dielectric matrix in a very, very fast way, which made all the difference. And which made all the difference for us to be able to do very, very large scale calculation. So what is epsilon? So to understand epsilon, we need to go back to Maxwell equation. So, and this is taken from this book, which explained this very nicely, and not in the main part of the book, in some of the appendices, but really explained this very nicely. So I will not go through all the details, but so what is epsilon? And here is epsilon and epsilon to the minus one. So epsilon, this complicated function of space and frequency, is the response of a system, solid, liquid, you name it, to the total electric field. And epsilon to the minus one, for example, the electromagnetic field hitting the system, right? And epsilon to the minus one is the response to the external field, which is independent of the material. So again, we are going to compute epsilon to the minus one, and we are going to understand what it is. It is the response to the total field independent of the material, coming from the Maxwell equations, and we are going to compute it using states coming from density functional theory. So what is epsilon? Epsilon is the response of any system in the presence of an electromagnetic field, a response to the external field. See here? And you can derive it. You go to that book or to any other book. That book is really very good in summarizing it. And it is related to the way E, the total field, and D, the external field acting to the system, are related to each other. And next step is that we want to express epsilon when E, the field, is derived from a potential. This step is not obvious, but it's okay here, okay? So we now express epsilon to the minus one, and how do we compute it? We derive an expression of the direct and inverse dielectric response. This is color-coded, if you go back to that. The blue, see? Blue here is the external field, and red is the total field. So we derive an expression of the direct and inverse dielectric response in terms of single particle cone states from density response function. So all the rest are formulas, and I will, you know, go very fast, but the concepts here are very important, because this is how the whole GW field of computing sigma, the self-energy, and computing W has been built upon. You compute the dielectric response, which is the response either to the external potential or to the Coulomb potential, external or total field, by expressing this response, by expressing the dielectric response in terms of density response function, and hence calculation from density functional theory. Okay? So if we understand this, the rest is all fine. So the rest is we go to the response of an electron, so to a variation of the potential. And see here, I'm saying this is what we do. We do a response density. We use density response function. We use perturbation theory. So this is the definition, the black one. Then we use perturbation theory. Everything here is in a perturbative mode. And then we derive all these functions, okay? So these are a lot of formulas. And if we wanted to understand all the indices and all that, we will have to spend a lot of time that we don't have because I want to get to some examples. But the point is here, I'm just really doing this. I'm expressing the dielectric response, and I'm deriving an expression from density response function, epsilon to the minus one in terms of dielectric response function. Okay, so I do this in terms of also the frequency, and I get to what I want, which is an expression of the inverse dielectric function in terms of the Coulomb potential and of density response function. This chi zero is a density response function, and this is a term which is related to the derivative of the exchange correlation potential. So why do I want all this? Because I want to compute. This is an expression that I can compute. I do a DFT calculation. Of course, I know the Coulomb potential. And I know how to compute density response function from perturbation theory, because I do density functional theory. I have single particle states, and I know how to compute this. I have the exchange correlation potential, and I know how to compute this. then I know how to compute the screened W. I know how to compute the Green's function, and I know how to do perturbatively GW calculation. Okay? So the logic is Dyson equation, incredibly complicated. I need to find a closure for. Heading comes up with an approximate form of Dyson that I use. And I go even further, and I use an approximate form of heading where I just say that my self-energy sigma is GW, Green's function times W, and then I relate the inverse dielectric matrix to density response functions that I use to compute epsilon to the minus one from density functional theory. By doing that, I have a formalism which allows me to compute GW correction from density functional theory. Okay, so what we have done, let me skip this. What we have done, which is which has allowed, and we started working on this a long time ago, what we have done, which has allowed us to do very large scale calculation, is basically to do an eigenvalue decomposition of the dielectric matrix here. Just look at this formula here. And to compute this by using density functional perturbation theory in such a way that we do not need to compute any empty or virtual single particle state. This is a huge deal. So if you look at this expression here, if I go back and you look at this expression here, see, this density response function that you have to compute to get epsilon to the minus one has a very nasty sum on occupied states. They are finite. You know what they are in a system. And also all empty bands up to, you know, I don't know which level. So this is a very difficult sum to converge and very difficult sum to compute, especially if you have very large systems. And this chi zero enters this expression here. See, the expression that you need to do all your GW calculation. So we remove that sum by turning the problem completely around and saying, let me not do this sum at all, and let me express my epsilon and epsilon to the minus one in terms of an eigenvalue decomposition. You know, the details are in these papers. You can read them. But the important thing is that if you do this, and if you use density functional perturbation theory, and this is a very nice paper written by Stefano Baroni et al. In Review of Modern Physics on Density Functional Perturbation Theory. If you do this, then you do not have to compute a lot of empty states. And this is what makes possible to do calculation for very, very large systems. And there are a lot of details. And if you're interested, you can read them in my slides or in the original references.
I think we have a short question from...
So I have a question about this because usually in traditional GW calculation, you need to include large cutoff to the empty state. So my question is how this works for some pathological material, for example, zinc oxide. How this procedure is working with, for example, band gap of zinc oxide, which is known to be, you one need to add large empty state to get the right, like, spectral like a shift. So how this is working well with zinc oxide, for example?
So we do not compute empty states at all.
Yeah. So yes, but there is no free launch. So you are doing something like fast. That means you are. I'm. My question is. I mean, when this. How can I say? Because some material I need to add in traditional GW, many empty state, up to like 20, like many. But what you are saying is I don't need to do that. So what's your approximation in doing that is maybe my core question.
So I'm sorry, I couldn't, maybe because of the microphone.
Right.
Can somebody repeat the question?
I think his question was when does this approximation break down, like in zinc oxide or in some other challenging materials? Is there an example where this simplification doesn't work?
No. This is a thing which is very important to understand. This is not an approximation. This is not cutting on empty space. This is a way of rewriting the dielectric matrix by doing a eigenvalue decomposition and by using density functional theory. So you have to include a certain number, of course, of eigenvectors and eigenvalues, and you have to do a solution of a Ternheimer equation, and you may ask the question, is it always more efficient than including a lot of empty states? And for all systems that we have considered so far and that other people have considered, it is much more efficient. But from the point of view of if it's working or not, it is working just as well as using empty states. So you can see this just as a change of basis set to represent your dielectric matrix. When you have empty states, you choose a basis set that are plane waves to reproduce your empty states or something. Here, we have a different basis set, which are the eigenpotential of the dielectric matrix to represent our problem. This is a complete basis set. So as long as you keep adding states, you are guaranteed to converge. So this is not an approximation.
Okay, but what about the truncation? What about the truncation? This truncation, you know, is it done the same way for all materials, or there are some materials where you have to do it differently?
Yes. Absolutely. The truncation, so let me give you an example. So, but it's a very important distinction to make. So it's a matter of efficiency. It's not that we are introducing a different approximation. So the truncation is shown here. So let me say one thing that also is very important, and then I'll tell you about the truncation. Because we represent this in terms of an eigenvalue decomposition, we accomplish another incredibly important thing, which is you do not have to invert the dielectric matrix, and you don't have to store the full matrix. If you still had to invert it or to store it, you would not be able to do calculation for a very large system. You have not changed the scaling. The scaling is n to the fourth, but you have changed the prefactor so much that now you can do calculation for large systems because there is no inversion and no storage of FUMA. This is very important. So how much I'll get back to that in a minute just to understand how to. Actually, let me tell this and then just to give you an idea. So in Hartree Fock, these are the elements that you are computing, and this is what happens in reciprocal space. If you do a W calculation without doing our eigenvalue decomposition, you have a full matrix in G space for W. Because of our trick, you have a low rank decomposition of your W, and so you are down to a number of basis functions which are much, much smaller than what you would have otherwise. This is a huge saving, and this is a calculation. You can go through this yourself. For 64 water molecules, that now 512 electrons we can do on our cluster in 10-15 minutes, and it would take a long time if you were to do a calculation, the old way. But so truncation, yes, truncation. So this is how the truncation works. So what do we look at? We look at is epsilon to the minus one. So the eigenvalue of the dielectric matrix go to one, right? They converge to one. And so we look at how the convergence of the eigenvalues actually is towards one, and what is the difference and the error that we make when we start. This is to zero because it's epsilon minus one, but it doesn't matter. And what is that the error that we make when we do a truncation when we are close to one? And this is, we have done this calculation. These, for example, are silicon clusters. You see these are big clusters. And there is another very big advantage of this is that when all these eigenvalues start being very close to one, you don't even need to compute them because they are approximated very well by model dielectric functions. And so this is an additional saving that you have. But to answer your question, the truncation affects how the truncation affects the system is checked in the same way as you check your plane weight cutoff. You try to include more eigenvalues, and you see when the results doesn't change. And so far, all the savings that we have observed are orders of magnitude. I mean, I'm not making this up. They are orders of magnitude. You know, these, for example, this is a calculation where we have done a silicon-silicon nitride interface, and these are all the eigenpotential of the dielectric matrix that we plot at each step for, 1,000 electrons. And we look at how they are localized or delocalized in the system, and we also look at how, the eigenvalues are, close or far from 0 or 1. And we also discovered another important thing, that if you do a plane wave calculation, the cutoff that you need to represent your dielectric matrix is not very large. This is important, but very technical. Okay. So let me summarize the GW algorithm, and I am out of time, right?
Some more time for questions. We have about half an hour more.
Okay. But we had already
a lot of questions, so you know.
Okay, let me summarize the algorithm. So we do an iterative diagonalization of the dielectric matrix. Again, this is not an approximation. This is a different way of rewriting epsilon. And once you rewrite epsilon, you can check how many eigenpotential include. And you are using a basis set, which is, by definition of basis set, complete, and you can fully converge it. By doing so, we can make a low rank decomposition of the screened Coulomb interaction. We use techniques based on density functional perturbation theory. And one thing that I didn't have time to explain, we use Langshaw's algorithms to do finite frequency. Finite frequency integration is very important. If you do cos x, if you don't include finite frequency in a lot of systems, you make huge mistakes. This is the code that where we have implemented all this. Again, it's an open source code. You can download it from the web, from our website. This is a code that has been scaled on a high-performance architecture. This is a scaling on Myra at Argonne. And this is a code that you can also use on your Mac. You don't need you don't need Myra at Argonne, but you can use the same code on Myra. And this is the code for which you can do GW calculation for thousands of electrons that were not possible before. You can converge them. You can check convergence. Before I close, I want to show you two examples, and I want to make two points. It's very important to validate your data. And validation is not just comparing with experiment. So we are making available on the web what we call data collection for GW calculation, where we compare with other codes, all electron input, other type of input, and where also we compare data obtained by starting from different functionals. These are gradient-corrected functionals. These are hybrid functionals. And we give, you know, if you go there and you click on that website, you will see everything that we compute and how it is compared and how it is converged. Always remember, the fact that you agree with the experiment may not mean that you are doing a good calculation. You may agree with the experiment by choosing a very lousy basis set and not converging your calculation. It doesn't mean anything. In order to understand how good your theory is compared to experiment, you need to converge all the numerical parameters. And this is what we're trying to highlight here for GW calculations. And this is, for example, you know, a comparison with the errors compared to other codes. And you can, you know, look for yourself and try to understand how to judge the numerical quality of these calculations. This is for molecules. We are working with other groups now to do the same. We are working for solids. It will be online in 4 or 5 months. And these, again, are the type of system that we can do, you know, 400 atoms, 1,000 of electrons. And one very important thing that I want, this is not for one configuration that you can do this. We can do this for many configurations over an MD trajectory. So the last thing that we can do this for spin in spin defects, and this has been done for, you know, materials for quantum information technology. One thing that I want to say here is the following. This is the spectrum of water, salty water, that I presented at the beginning. Huge difference depending on the starting point. The starting point in GW is very important. And so once we saw that, and because we have doubts about self-consistent GW, we spent a lot of time actually going back and using our self-energy to develop approximate hybrid functionals that then we use as input for GW. And the approximate hybrid functional that we developed are dielectric-dependent hybrids, and they are implemented in QBox, in quantum espresso, and also in quantum chemistry codes. And if you go on, you know, there are two PRB papers where basically the screening constant that we put in the hybrid is the epsilon infinity, the dielectric constant. And, of course, I'm out of time. You have the slides, and you can look at all this. And by doing this, we were able to do a calculation of a photoelectron spectrum of water, which really compares really nicely with experiment. And one thing that I would like to point out here is that these are not density of states. The intensities of these peaks are computed as imaginary part of the self-energy. So here, we can really do the whole business. We can do ab initio molecular dynamics with hybrid functionals, which we have derived from approximate form of the self-energy. We can do GW calculation for many trajectories. We can compute intensities from the imaginary part of the self-energy. We can determine the absolute position of the peaks by doing calculation of the surface of water, and this is the agreement with experiment that we have. And this is the first time that a photoelectron spectra with absolute position of peaks was presented. Okay, I will actually stop and tell you, so in closing, that once you have all this, you can actually do transfer calculation. You have total energies, you can do your GW, you can do constrained DST for hopping transport, and if you know all the formulas, they are here, you can do really transport calculation based on state-of-the-art electronic structure. So this is my group. I need to acknowledge the support by what happened to NSF logo. Oh, my God. Anyway, I need to acknowledge support from NSF. Argon, LDRD support, the U.S. Department of Energy, all these supports from Computational Science and also from the University of Chicago. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much for a very exciting talk, Giulia. And now let's see if we have some more questions.
Sorry about the rush on the last part, but we had question at the beginning, so I was a little bit slow. But anyway,
hello.
So if you have question and you want me in these, you know, remaining time to go over some of the concepts of GW or excited state, I'd be very happy to.
Hello, Giulia. Silke speaking. Thanks a lot for your nice talk. And I'm interested in particular, of course, in this part of how to speed up the calculation of the response. And I would be interested in your opinion on a work that I saw appear last year from a group in Buffalo who were proposing actually to still calculate the response by the sum of empty states in principle, but somehow to divide that part into a part really influenced by the crystal potential and a part approximatable by some kind of free electron approximation. So there was some paper you might have seen on archive in January last year. So the first author was Wei Wei Gao, the last one Pei Hong Zhang. Have you seen that or not?
You said Wei Tao Yang or no?
The last author is Pei Hong Zhang. First author Wei Wei Gao. There was an archive in January.
Oh yeah. Actually, yes. So you know, the concepts are actually related to we even wrote a proposal together with Wei Tao, which was not funded, by the way, but anyway, last year. So the concepts are very much related in the sense that so here we have a way of computing epsilon from density functional perturbation theory by looking at by computing these eigenvalue and eigenvectors as a response to different fields of different wavelengths applied to the system. And in a way, that idea is not too dissimilar in the sense that you want, instead of doing a full expansion and inverting the matrix, do a response calculation. They separate the response from different wavelengths, and we don't. I discussed with Wei Tao, and I think that separating the response depending on the wavelength can be really messy, depending if you have a very, you know, complicated system. But the concept is not dissimilar. I mean, the concept that they put forward is kind of similar to ours, to compute response function, and they divide up the response in terms of wavelength, which I'm not sure is possible for all systems. That's what I can say right now.
Do you have other questions?
You say that the incorporation of exchange correlation kernels is in principle straightforward. Does that also apply if you have a frequency dependence in the exchange correlation kernel?
This is not okay. Let me look here. So, so you can, but we have not. It is not. If you look at these formulas and how you derive the relation between the response to the total and to the external field, and where the exchange correlation kernel appears, and you generalize this to a dynamical response, you can do it. We, in practice, have never done it. And we believe, we are thinking about this problem, we believe, but I don't have a robust response for this, that if you really want to do this, you should not use the density functional perturbation theory anymore, but you should use a response in finite field, which would be much easier to do. And we are actually testing these ideas as we speak, but we have never done a calculation where there is an omega here as on paper.
Okay, thank you very much. Here's another question.
Hello, Giulia. It's Warren Pickett. Can we see the photo emission spectrum of water again? This may be a little detail. So down between minus 20 and minus 30 on this figure, it looks like there's a gap, but the experiment has some spectral weight there. Do you know where that's coming from?
The experiment has
spectral weight between minus 30 and minus 20, whereas the theory seems to say there's a gap there, which is...
Oh, yeah, middle. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So, that, that's a very good question. So, actually, this is not a detail. There is a nice story related to this. And so when we did these calculations, we did this calculation for a specific solution at this concentration because of the number of sodium and chloride that we can put in our 64-atom cell and 128-molecule cell. And this was not the concentration that experimentally they had. So we asked experimentalists to do a measurement at our concentration, and we were sure they would say no, but they said yes. And we ended up publishing with them. And this here happens at all concentrations, and it is related to something that we do not and they do not fully understand, which is how they treat and how we treat this cross-section. So basically, the intensities are computed in this way, where you have this function, which is computed from the imaginary part of the self-energy, and these are our eigenvalues. But then you have this cross-section, and this cross-section contains parameters that we take from experiments which are related to the temperature of this experiment. Here, there is a specifically a beta parameter. So we can reproduce this if we use a temperature different than the temperature than they use, but we don't know what it means. So the short answer is we don't know.
Okay.
The long answer is we know and we have tested that this part here is related to how we change this cross-section, but we haven't understood the physics yet.
Other questions? I actually have a short question related to that. My understanding is that many people, when they use GW, et cetera, they use this quasi-particle approximation, which doesn't quite calculate the scattering, inelastic scattering rate in a fully self-consistent fashion. That's my impression. Even though, you know, if you could do it fully self-consistently at finite temperature, then you may get a different answer for the scattering rate. So is this related to this issue here or not?
Well, I mean, our calculation here are strictly perturbative.
Right. But so are there people who do, for example, solve this is fully self-consistent solution calculated actually at finite temperature? Is there such work done even by anyone?
You say X-ray?
The fully self-consistent solution done at finite temperature, rather than
there are self-consistent solutions and okay, so let me say that we have done self-consistent solution to. We are not sure we know what they mean because this is a problem. So when you do a self-consistent solution, you need to compute a derivative of your self-energy. But if you do not include in your self-energy this kind of cold gamma term here, you have an inconsistency in how you compute your derivative. And many people just compute derivative forgetting about this gamma. Uh-huh. And there are inconsistencies there, and we haven't understood yet. Maybe somebody has, but we haven't understood yet how to compute this derivative in a fully consistent way. So numerically, you can solve whatever you want, but physically, I'm not sure I understand fully self-consistent GW.
Okay. See, I'm asking because I have a DMFT background, and in DMFT is the good way to compute this. Basically, its biggest advantage is to calculate the self-energy in inelastic part scattering at high temperatures where you are far from the quasi-particle regime. So that's, you know, the biggest advantage you get from this, and the price to pay that you have butchered the momentum dependence, but you have a rather accurate description of this incoherent regime. Whereas, you know, a lot of, I mean, I think this GW is more focused on the you should work better in the coherent regime, which is kind of Fermi liquid-like, I guess.
Yeah, I see what you're saying. I'm not sure I have a lot of things to say about that.
Well, these are open questions. Are there other questions? Here's another question.
As far as I understood it, one of the problems with a self-consistent GW was that it's hard. So W is huge, right? And does because it has all these frequencies and this large index structure, does your decomposition scheme actually help with that? So does that get you closer to that, or is the main problem really this gamma and that you have some inconsistency there?
So we need always to distinguish algorithmic problems and physical problems. So we can do a very good job, and we do a great job computing W and being able to compute it for large system because of this. Because we have a way of computing having an eigenvalue decomposition of epsilon, and hence when we do this matrix element, we have a low rank decomposition of W, which makes W as difficult or close to being as difficult as Hartree-Fock, which is a great algorithmic advantage, and which is why we can do many configuration of many system much larger than people were able to do before. Because we have this, we can also compute the derivatives of derivative here, if we want, of the self-energy in a relatively simple way. So this is the algorithmic part. The physics part is, does it make sense to do a self-consistent GW when my sigma, it is just G and W, instead of being what it should be, meaning GW gamma, which is this additional term here. If I determine, and I'm not sure, that I can do self-consistent GW just by treating sigma as GW, yes, I can do that. I can do that, and I can do that easily from the algorithmic point of view. From the physics point of view, we have not solved the problem because we don't know whether we should really include gamma when we do our derivative. So what is the derivative that I'm talking about? When you do self-consistent GW, you need a derivative of your sigma, right, to do the self-consistent. And if we need gamma, well, we have a long way to go to compute gamma really in an optimized way. So if GW is your problem, we can solve it quite well. Whether this is what you should be doing in self-consistent GW, I don't know. And if you need gamma, we need an extra step that we haven't solved yet to do this efficiently.